So how is everyone today?
Mighty fine, how about yourself?
Mighty fine. So, are there any questions about the assignments so far? Any questions about them? So, notably, we're coming to the end, aren't we? Because there's this week, and then there's next week. And then that's the end of lectures. That's nice. Not just for this class, but for all, right? So, we're going to do one more new thing this week, and then that is a new topic. We'll do a new topic this week. And then next week we won't do a new topic, but we will have several written homeworks that are due that are just using MATLAB to solve exercises that you already knew how to solve without MATLAB. And then that'll be the end. So any question about the way it's going to, the way the course will close out? Yes?
Yeah, we don't have a final in here, do we?
There's no final. There's no final because, at least to me, it doesn't, in the end, the purpose of this class is to teach you how to use a tool. And I think it's kind of clear that it's a very general purpose tool that can solve general purpose problems. And they don't really get solved in a test setting. It's more like, okay, well, I can't see how to do it, so maybe I'll Google something, or maybe I'll do this or that. It's just impossible to make an examination out of it. But we'll solve a bunch of written exercises. And you'll turn them in as homework.
When's the last day to, I guess, submit the programming homework?
Okay, so let me write that down, because that'll be something everyone wants to know. Today's what, the 18th?
Yes.
So, last day to turn things in. Last day for GitHub submissions, that is. Is going to be 2017, May 4. So I can say, may the 4th be with you. Terrible.
That's a good way to remember
it. So, what that means is that you can make as many corrections between now and then as you wish. And we'll say that it's at 23:59:59. Okay, to be clear. So, some of you have been a little lax in submitting your GitHub work. Okay. I can't really recommend that strategy, but if you, you know, in the end, what's submitted to the university is wherever you are when the course terminates. So, okay, fine. I strongly recommend that you start solving the exercises, any ones that you haven't solved. One reason is that you may run into unforeseen difficulties. For example, you might not understand the exercise. Another thing is that, you know, some elements, you may believe that you understand the exercise, and you may even pass the test that's written in MATLAB, but then when I inspect your code, if you haven't used the correct algorithm, then you won't get credit. And I'll send you a message that says, you didn't use the correct algorithm, I need you to modify it. And if that, you know, the doomsday scenario is that you've got a handful of these and you don't have enough time to go through it all. So don't wait to the last second. Highly unwise. Any question about any of that? Any questions about the written homeworks? Should be pretty straightforward. Solving exercises that you more or less already knew how to do. Yes? I make no promises about the curve. So probably not. Because, you know, I essentially give you not infinite, because that's not correct, but essentially unlimited number of submissions for your exercises. So probably no curve. But, you know, if it so happens, say, that homework 21, you know, only one person was able to get it, then I won't be oblivious to that. I don't even know which one homework 21 is.
Newton's method.
Newton's method?
Okay. Yeah.
So that one's pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Other questions? Okay. So, what were we talking about last time?
Fibonacci.
MATLAB. Fibonacci, right? So, any questions about Fibonacci? So, notably, I'd like to point out that we talked about three procedures to evaluate the Fibonacci function, a sequence being a function from the naturals to the reals. So, we figured out three different ways to evaluate the Fibonacci function. One of them took what amounts to an exponential number of steps. The doubly recursive way to evaluate the Fibonacci function is just absolutely terrible from a time standpoint. Then we said, well, we can do better than this by just using the sort of human algorithm, which is to say, well, I know that the first two are 0 and 1, and then the next one is the sum of those, and I can forget the first one. The next one is the sum of the two that I currently remember. So I can remember that one and forget one, and then compute the next one and forget one, and compute the next one and forget one. And that works pretty well. So if I wanted you, in that style, if I wanted you to compute the 1,000th Fibonacci number, it would take you 1,000 steps. And then, surprise, surprise, most students are not surprised at the linear algorithm. They're like, yeah, yeah, okay. Then, it is a little bit of a surprise, I think, that in fact you can evaluate the 1,000th Fibonacci number in about 10 steps by construing the Fibonacci.
Yeah, matrices. Yeah, you can just like recursively make the matrices like, oh, this is the matrix to the fourth power, and then you can say, oh, that's.
Yes, this. You can construe the Fibonacci relation as a matrix recurrence. And so you can finding the 1,000th, say, Fibonacci number is equivalent to finding the 1,000th power of a matrix. And we talked about repeated squaring on a number of occasions. And you can do it just there. It's really quite surprising. So we went from an exponential algorithm to a linear algorithm to a logarithmic algorithm. It doesn't hardly get any more stark than that. Okay, so what do we want to talk about now? Okay, so there's a game. It has a name, but I'm gonna not say the name because I'm gonna see if any of y'all know the name. But I didn't come up with it, it's a named game. So let's imagine, it's not this one.
Is it Nim again?
Sorry?
Is it Nim again?
It's not Nim.
Is it Fibonacci Nim?
I don't even know this one. Okay, so there's an object. And now it's obscured.
It's called Ricard Conti.
Nearly there now.
Balls and cups.
Okay, so here's the way it works. Is that now you know that it's there. For the first round of the game. We'll number the cups by position left to right as 1, 2, 3, so that we're clear that this is cup 1, 2, and 3. So this is the idea. I'm going to ask, it's a two-player game, and I ask you, which cup do you want? And your goal is to find the green one. So you already know it's that one, but in general you wouldn't know. So your game is to guess which one do I want. So let's say that you selected this one. So you say, I like cup number one. And then I say to you, okay, now I'd like to point out that cup number three does not have the thing that you're looking for. Would you care to switch?
Yes.
Or would you like to stay?
This is a game show.
Switch.
It is a Monty Hall.
What is it called?
Monty Hall.
The Monty Hall problem. So now I'd like to, so the way it went is I said, select a cup. You said, okay, cup number one. Then I say, okay, now I'd like for you to observe that cup number three does not have the prize. Would you care to switch? Okay, and then if you happen to switch, then you get it. And if you don't happen to switch, if you say, no, I'd like to stay, then you don't get it. Okay, so it's a game, and the way it works is you make a guess, and then I say, that's a nice guess you have there. But I'd like to point out that this other one, I always show you one where it's not. So I have to know where it is because I have to show you a cup where it isn't. Then I ask you if you want to switch. So now, my question to you is, and the question, so someone already said it, so I'll write it down. This is called the Monty Hall problem, or the Monty Hall game. So once I reveal to you a cup where it isn't, then there's two cups. Now what's going to be the best strategy? To stay or to switch?
To switch every time.
To switch every time. But I'd like to, do you have a question?
Well, I admit that, I think this is a famous problem and the result is maybe known. I'm confused as to why it is, because naively, let's say there's two cups, and showing us one that is empty, there's two cups and there's still one, dice at large.
Right.
If you pick a cup, you only had a 1/3 chance of getting it right, and that's still the same, even if he shows you what's underneath the different cup.
So
he's eliminated one possible solution.
He's eliminated a solution, so now there's only really two options that you have. But the option that you started off with was only 1/3. It only was going to work 1/3 of the time.
Right, and now you have a 50-50 chance, if you were to call
it.
If we just started at two cups, right, and he just put a dice into one, it's 50-50.
Yeah,
right?
if you had two cups. But if you have three cups, then the chance of you getting it right the first time is 1 out of 3.
Right.
And that doesn't change if he eliminates one of the cups.
It's interesting, right? It's interesting. Point of view is to try and think about what's happening. It does seem as if, presently, now that there's two cups, it might seem as if the odds are 50-50. Like, okay, there shouldn't be a bias towards staying or switching. Many people come to this conclusion, but it's just not right. And the purpose of this discussion is to show you that switching is in fact the optimal strategy, assuming that there's no collusion between the host and the player. Okay. So let's play. So let's try a couple. Is there a pause freeze? Okay. So let's play a couple. Okay, so we're going to use the strategy of, we're going to do both strategies, switch and stay, and maybe even a random strategy, but for now, which one do we want to test first? Do we want to test the switching strategy or the staying strategy?
Switching.
Okay, we want to test switching. Okay, so I need a volunteer.
Are we doing a Monte Carlo method for the Monte Carlo problem?
Yes. Yes. Okay, so then I need a volunteer. Okay. Which one do you want to choose?
The first one.
Okay. So that's nice. I'd like to point out to you that the third cup is not a winner. Would you like to switch or would you like to stay?
I would like to switch.
Okay. So then, you lost. Okay. So that's fine. So under the switch strategy, we've played once, and we lost, which I guess I'll signify with a zero. Now don't watch me do it, cheaters. Okay. I can only remove ones that
right.
are empty.
You can't remove one with the dice in it.
Right. In the original game, it's not that it was empty. It's that there were there were three cups, if you like, really three curtains, and behind two of the curtains were goats.
The real point is you're doing the filtering, right?
Yes. Okay. So now I need a volunteer. Okay. Which one would you like to select?
Two.
Okay. Now, I'd like to point out, that's a nice guess, I'd like to point out to you that cup number one is not a winner. So, would you like to switch or to stay?
Is it my choice?
It's not. Because we're doing switch.
Oh, okay, yeah, switch.
Okay. But yes, it is your, in principle, it's your choice.
Yeah.
Okay, so you switch to cup number three, it's a winner. Okay. Okay, can I have a volunteer? Okay, which one would you like?
Three.
Okay. That's a nice get. Oh wait, can I even remember? Okay, just a second. Okay. Okay. So that's a nice guess you have there, but I'd like to point out that cup number two is not a winner. Would you like to switch or stay?
I'm at a gunpoint here, so I guess I kind of have to switch.
Okay. So, oh, wait a second. I said, so cup number two is not a winner. So then, it's a winner. You won. Okay, terrific. Okay. So we'll go to maybe 10 games. Okay, so then who'd like to play? Anyone? Okay.
Middle.
Okay, so then that's a nice guess you have there, but I'd like to point out that cup number three is not a winner. Would you like to switch or stay?
Switch.
Like to switch? Okay, who'd like to play? Which one would you like?
Cup number three.
Okay. I can't remember again. Okay. Okay, so that's a nice guess you have there, but I'd like to point out that the second cup is not a winner. Would you care to switch?
No.
You want to stay? Okay, so then I guess I'll make another column. So, stay, and so it was three, and you want to stay with three.
Mm-hmm.
That's a winner.
Well, couldn't we just record the outcomes for switch and stay, knowing that they're opposite? One of them has to contain the.
Right. Yeah, okay. I agree. Okay, at any rate, this is pretty laborious. So, let's write a MATLAB program that does this. Okay, we'll write a MATLAB program that iterates through, you know, several hundred or thousand games, and we'll see. I think we can all agree that, you know, if MATLAB, you know, regardless of your opinion about, you know, some of you might have informed opinions about statistics, say like I like the frequentist point of view, or I like the Bayesian point of view. Regardless of your point of view of statistics, can we agree that if we simulate the game for thousands and thousands and thousands of iterations, that if it turns out that switching is the better strategy, then it just is?
Yeah. Is there a way in MATLAB to randomly pick a
permutation from like S3 or something?
There is, and the name of the function is randperm.
Oh, okay.
Or something, it might be randomperm.
I think it's randperm.
It randperms, plural?
Yeah, I think so.
It's something like this. Okay, so now, let's see why it should be that switching is the optimal strategy. The way that you can establish, so this was just a bit of fun and to understand the way the game works. Okay, so then why should it be that switching is the optimal strategy? Okay, so for sake of argument alone, let's assume that the correct cup is cup number one. Okay, so here we are. This is the first choice. Choice number one. So from this choice, if the correct cup is cup number one, then, but you're uninformed of this, then you can choose cup number one, you can choose cup number two, or you can choose cup number three. Okay, so this is choice one for player one, or just the player.
This is the game tree?
Mm-hmm. So maybe you chose cup one, maybe you chose cup two, and maybe you chose cup three. So now that the player has made their first choice, now it's the host. Now it's my turn. Now I'm constrained to select for you a cup that's not a winner. Okay, so that means that if you get here, so when you get here, what are the two choices that I can reveal to you? I can reveal to you cup two or cup three. Okay, so cup two or cup three. Okay. supposing that we played the game and here now it's my turn again. What are my choices? I only have one choice, right? So if I'm here, if we know that the true answer is one, why is it that when we get here, I actually have no choice?
You can't reveal one.
Right. It would be exactly like this. So if the true cup is cup number one, and it's I've made it visible, right? And you said, well, I'm going to guess cup number two. So I say, okay, that's your guess. Now I'd like to point out to you that the following cup is not a winner. Which cup do I have to reveal? I have to reveal this one and say, that's not a winner. I can't reveal that one because, well, that is the winner, right? So does everyone see that at this position, I actually do not have a choice? Okay, I must reveal cup number three. And analogously, supposing we get here, what must I do?
Remove two.
Must remove two. Okay. So now, in any case, now it is your player. It is your turn to make a second choice. You can either switch or stay. So, now, if you initially selected cup three and I revealed cup two, then that means that three and one are the current choices. Right? Because you can't choose cup two, because I already revealed that it's not the answer. So, supposing you, if you switch, then which cup will you select from here?
One.
You've selected one. So this is switch. To one. And then we could also stay. With three. Now notably, which one of these, so these are end states of the game. That is to say, nothing else happens after here. Which one of these is a winner and which is a loser?
Switch is the winner.
Yeah, switch is the winner. So this is a winning state, and this is a losing state. So this is a win, and this is a loss. Okay, from here, you chose cup number two, I revealed cup number three, so that means that your choices are between one and two. So you can switch to one, or you can stay with two. So is it clear that those are the only moves that you have from here? So you can switch to one, or you can stay with two. Notably, which one of these is the winning? So these are both end states of the game. Which one is the winner? Switching to one is a winner, and staying with two is a loser. Okay, so now, that's what happens if you did not happen to select the winner on the first move. So now, if you selected the winner on the first move, that is to say, you said, I'm going to try cup number one. I'm running out of vertical space. Let's move this up a little bit. So you selected the winner. I revealed cup number two. So that means that you can switch to cup three, or you can stay with cup one. Okay, so if you switch, then that means that would be a switch to cup three, or you could stay with cup one. Now, which one is the winner and which one is the loser?
Staying
is the winner. So that's a winning state and that's a losing state. And then now, you selected the winner, I revealed a loser. The choices are now one and two. You could switch to two, or you could stay with one. So staying is the winner and switching is the loser. Now I'd like to point out that this is an exhaustive circumstance. There's no other possibilities here. Now, how many winning states are there?
Four.
How many losing states are there?
Four.
Okay, so now, would anyone care to revise their considerations about the game? Notice that there's four winning states, four losing states, which might lend credence to your thought that the second choice really is 50-50.
No, because then you need to do backwards deduction here.
Okay. So what were you going to say?
Just some of your staying on states are overlaps between each other. You're double counting kind of possibilities.
Okay.
You have a two-thirds chance of picking the loser right off the bat. And if you pick a loser and you switch, then you win. So you have a 66% chance of picking a loser and where switching will work. Whereas if you stay the second time, you're only going to win if you pick the winner, which is a 33% chance.
Okay, I like it.
And the problem with the tree is the hope. Like, when you count each of the host's possibilities on possibility one,
that doesn't really reflect the chances of your choices as like a player. Because in this case, you're like doubling the number of wins and losses associated with branch one.
Okay.
Even though relative to one, like two and three.
Okay.
They should be like the same number of possibilities. It should be the same number of possibilities to your perspective as a player for one, two, and three, but in this tree, that's not the case, so it doesn't really represent sort of like a probability tree. You can't really convert it to a probability tree, even though it is a decision tree, sort of.
Okay, then let's convert it exactly to a probability tree in the following way. Let's say that the player, in fact, in choice one, is going to uniformly randomly select between one, two, and three. Let's suppose that that is the case, which is to say, what is the probability that the player will choose one?
One-third.
A third. And two?
One-third.
A third. And three?
One-third.
A third. So that means that the probability of this trajectory right here is a third, this one is a third, and this one is a third. Okay. Now let's furthermore say that the host's single choice is going to be uniformly randomly selected. Now, that's going to be also circumscribed by the fact that the host must make a valid choice, which is to say the host is prohibited from revealing the winner. That being said now, suppose that we are here, that the correct answer is in fact one, unbeknownst to the player, but the host does know that. What is the probability that the host will reveal door number three? Well,
one half,
right?
Oh, but are we having it
total? Not cumulative,
okay.
Not yet. So there's a 50% probability that they'll reveal that wrong door, and there's a 50% probability that they'll reveal that wrong door. Now here's the place where it starts to become what y'all were saying, double counting and blah blah, everything like this. Suppose that we're here, that you have selected door number two, and the host knows that it is not the correct door. They know that, or cup, right? Well, door is the game. So in ours, it's cups. So you've selected cup number two, and the host knows that, in fact, the correct door, cup, is number one. So what is the probability that the host will select cup number three?
One.
One. Because the host has no other option. Similarly, from this position, what is the probability that the host will select door number, cup number two?
One.
Now, suppose that your strategy is to unconditionally switch. That is to say, you do have two choices. You can switch or you can stay. You can switch or you can stay, but let's suppose that you are going to switch. Or let's even do it differently. Let's say that you're just going to randomly select between switching and staying. Okay, so that means that on this branch, you have a 50% probability of selecting this one, a 50% probability of selecting that one, 50% probability, 50, 50, 50, 50, 50. So now, we want to assign the probability of getting to any one of these end states. So what's the probability? How do you calculate the probability of getting, say, to here?
Multiply the probability of each individual event.
Yeah, is that, now here's the point where we need to say that there's no collusion between the two players, so that each one of these is an independent action. So they haven't in advance said what exactly they're going to do. So what's the probability of getting to this losing state?
One-sixth.
What's the probability of getting to this winning state?
One-sixth.
What's the probability of getting to this losing state?
One-sixth.
To this one?
One-sixth.
To this winning state?
One-twelfth.
One-twelfth, right? Because it's a third times a half times a half. And to this one, and to this one, a 12th, and to this one, a 12th. So let's see. Do they add up?
Yeah.
So half, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so then they all add up because this is 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 twelves. Okay, so what if we now change the probabilities? What if we now change the probabilities and say that the player is definitely going to do something different? Instead of the player choosing uniformly randomly between switch and stay, what if they unconditionally switch? That is to say that there is zero probability that they will stay. So that means that this would get modified to being a 1 because we're definitely going to switch, and this would become a 0 because we're definitely not going to stay. And let's do that everywhere. So this is now a 0, this is now a 1, this is now a 0, this is now a 1, this is now a 0, this is now a 1. And now let's recalculate the green probabilities. So what's the probability of getting to this losing state? 0. What's the probability of getting to this winning state?
1/3.
What's the probability of getting to this losing state?
0.
And to this winning state?
1/3.
To this winning state?
0.
0. To this losing state?
1/6.
To this winning state?
0.
And to this losing state?
1/6.
So now, what is the probability of winning?
2/3.
1/3 plus 1/3 is 2/3. What is the probability of losing? So here's a losing state that's non-zero. Here's a losing state that's non-zero. That's 2/6. That's 1/3. So that means that with the unconditional strategy, the strategy of unconditional switch, 2 out of 3 games you'll win. Supposing that this is uniformly random, and this one too. Interesting. Watching the game tree play out. So in fact, this last switch, uniform random gives you, 50% chance of winning, I think. Whereas unconditional switch gives you 2/3 chance of winning. That was found out, if I remember my history correctly, that was found out relatively quickly in the game, because it was a game show, and then
they had to stop the show, right?
The word got out. Well, they didn't stop the show, but they stopped doing it that way. They changed it. They changed the rules of the game so that...
Oh, yeah.
So, very interesting. So now, here's a different way to understand the game. Suppose that instead of 3 cups, I give you, say, 10 cups. So that there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Suppose there's 10 cups and that this one is the winner. Cup number 3. Unbeknownst to you. Now, supposing that you select uniformly randomly, what is your probability of selecting the winner on the first choice?
1/10.
1/10, right? So can we all agree you have a 1/10 chance of selecting the winner on the first choice? Okay. Now what I'm going to do is to make it to where you have the same choice, that is switch or stay. So just like in this game, the last choice that you made was switch or stay. Suppose that I have to make it to where you're going to switch or stay, and you just have to have one choice. It's not switch to this one, switch to that one. It is, I'm going to stay with the cup, or I'm going to switch to the only other cup. So, how many do I need to reveal?
Eight.
There's 10. So I have to reveal how many?
Eight.
I have to reveal 8, so that you have the same choice, that I'm going to stay with this cup or switch to the only other cup. So suppose that I reveal, I say, well, as it happens,
none of these are winners. so you selected, for sake of argument, let's say that you selected this one. And so I reveal those two, that one, and all of these.
So that those, that your blue choice and the red cup, which has not been examined, are the only possibilities. So should you switch or should you stay?
Switch.
You should switch. Because what is the effect of me revealing all but one cup?
Essentially filtering down all the options to just one. And so the question is, do you have your probability, which is in this case 1 in 10 of, mm-hmm. of just actually picking the right one, or the 9 in 10 chance that you filter it down to the correct one? Or 18 in 9, I guess it is.
Right. So then you have a probability of 1 in 10 of choosing it. So it's highly improbable that you chose it in the first place. So that's the most probable situation is you selected incorrectly. And then I will follow that up by removing all but one cup. So you're choosing between what's the probability that you chose correctly, and then I revealed all but the wrong cup, or you chose wrongly and then I chose all but the right, I revealed all but the correct cup. So the reason why switching is 2/3 probability is because what the real choice is after you examine all the possible game trees is, did I choose correctly in the first place or did I not? Well, the probability is that you did not. So if we played the game with 10 cups, you have a 90% chance of winning if you switch. If we played with 100 cups, you have a 99% probability of winning if you switch, because you will almost surely have selected the wrong cup, and then I'll reveal 98 other cups, and you're choosing between, well, who's more? Am I more likely to have guessed correctly or not in the first place? Good. Any questions about the Monty Hall game? So there's lots, even with all of this discussion, which is more or less unassailable, Many people go back to the game and they think, well, there's just two cups, though. Why is it not 50-50? Okay, fine. We will program out the whole game, and then we'll just run a simulation, and we'll just agree that if the simulation shows that switching is the winning strategy, then it just is. I say this because there's actually a great number of very intelligent people, even you know, physicists, stat people, who still, it's kind of, they get a little bit queasy when they think about the Monty Hall problem. They're, for real. Good. Any question about that? Okay. Another consideration, completely unrelated. So let's consider this function. F of x is, say, 5x plus 1, and then we're going to compute this modulo, say, 2370. And f is going to be a function from the naturals to the naturals. And I'll write a little subscript 0 to mean that I'm construing the naturals to include the zeros here. Different people have different opinions on that. Yes?
Would it also be correct to say like a Z2370?
Yes.
Just as fine. But the prerequisite for this course is precalculus. So I'm going to avoid as much as possible algebra.
What is the technical term for it? Is it called a ring or a cyclotomic ring or something like that?
Probably the most basic one is just the integers modulo 2370.
I believe that's what you're right.
It is ring.
Kind of,
yeah. Okay. So now, we're going to do the following. We're going to evaluate this function And then we're going to repeatedly evaluate this function. We're going to keep iterating over and over and over and over again. So I want you to compute iterated values of x is equal to 0. That is to say that we're going to use the notation that f superscript n evaluated at x means f composed with f composed with composed with f evaluated at x, and there are n such f's. And as a matter of convention, we're going to hold that f with superscript 0 means the identity function. Which is to say, what is the identity function evaluated at x?
X.
So let's make a table here. So then we're going to have two columns, n and f n evaluated at x, and the value of x is going to be 0. So when n is 0, the value of x is 0, so the identity function evaluated at 0 is what?
0.
So now let's say that we apply f to 0. So what do we get when we do that? That is, what is this function evaluated at 0?
1.
It's 1, because it'd be 5 times 0 is 0, plus 1 is 1, and the 1 modulo 2370 is 1. Okay. Now what I want you to do is I want you to take this output, 1, and use it as input again. So what is this function evaluated at 1? 6. Okay? Because 5 times 1 is 5, plus 1 is 6, modulo 2370 is 6. Now use 6 as input to this function.
31.
5 times 6 is 30, plus 1 is 31, modulo 2370. 31. Now I need a calculator. Or I'm going to need one in just a second. So that was the third evaluation. So now I want you to use this output as input to the function again. What is it?
156.
That sounds right. We'll go with that. Now I want you to use that output as input.
156 times 5 plus 1.
I get 781. Now I want you to use that output as input.
5 times 781 plus 1.
So now we have a number that's more than 2370. So up to now, we've been oblivious to the fact that this is all being computed modulo 2370. But I just calculated it, and it's 3906. And then construing this modulo 2370, that is congruent, is equivalent to what? Well, let's subtract 2370.
$1,536.
Okay, so does everyone see how that occurred? So now I want you to use this as input. Okay? That's definitely going to be more than 2370. So 1536 times 5 plus 1. That is 7681. Which is going to be congruent to what? Minus 2 times 2370? Nope, 3 of them. 571. So is there any question how we're computing these values? 571 here.
Is this okay so far? Okay, let's continue. So the eighth one. So 571 plus 1. So that's 2856. So this is all construed mod 2370. Minus 2370. 486. Now, we're going to keep evaluating. But I have a question as we're continuing this evaluation. How many different values could I possibly get?
4,370 or less.
Or less, right? So does everyone agree that as I'm computing this table, 2431, 2431, which is equivalent to 2431? No, it's not. What am I saying? So it's 61. So it's conceivable that there's, well, in fact, there's only 2370 possible output values of this function, right? 0, 1, 2, all the way up to 2369. Okay, it's not possible for it to output any other value. So here's my, I hope it starts repeating here in a minute. 306. times 5 plus 1. 1531. Oh. One, 1531 times 5 plus 1 minus 3 2370s is 546. Has anybody gotten further than me? Yes? Has it started cycling yet?
No.
Not yet.
Yeah, but I know the function that you use, like the...
Oh, look. 546. 546 times 5 plus 1 is what? 2731. So 13 here. So this would be 2731, and then we have to do this modulo 2370. So this is congruent 1 modulo 2370. Okay. Now we're back on wall power. Okay. So so that's not right. 2731 modulo 2370. So this much minus 2370.
You get 546.
I don't know. Is that not right? So
times 5 plus 1 is more than 2370.
What? So do we agree with 1531?
Yep.
Okay, 1531 times 5 plus 1 is 7656. And then now I'm going to subtract 3 2370s. And I get 546. So the arithmetic is working out for me.
It repeats at n is equal to 475.
Does it?
Yeah.
Okay. So, blah, 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 blah. At where?
N is 475. Yields, I believe it yields back to the 1. F of n is equal to 1.
It goes to 1?
Yeah.
Okay. You might think so,
yeah,
but that's not necessarily true.
N equals 0 opens off by 1, and 474 divides 2370.
So,
it has to be a divisor of a multiple of the totients of the prime factors of 2370.
Does that
Okay, we're going to continue. Okay, so it's definitely an interesting discussion, but and these things are somewhat relevant and somewhat right. But we have to continue. Okay, so then it's going to do its thing for a while. But what I'd like to point out is, suppose that we computed a table of length 1 million. Suppose we did that. Surely it must be repeating.
Yeah, by the pigeonhole principle.
Yeah, and so why must it be repeating? Someone who's preferably shy. Why must it eventually start repeating? Yeah?
Because each value uniquely determines its next one. It can only have so many values.
Right. Suppose that, just for sake of argument, I'm not saying that it's true because I didn't calculate it. Suppose that this one turns out to be 781. If that so happened to be true, what would be the next value? It would have to be 1536, which is to say that if we went all the way down here and this was the first repeat, so if this was the first repeat, then from here on, it would get caught in this cycle. That is to say, if this is the first repeat, then it's going to go through all of these until it gets here, and then it essentially jumps back to the top and starts listing them all out again. Yes?
Are you saying that it could repeat from not the first iteration?
I am saying that. I'm saying that this bit right here, maybe this can be made arbitrarily long. Well, it can't be made longer than that. Right. So, the name for this problem, because of the following shape, so you can imagine the trajectory of this sort of looks like, okay, we're going down the table, and then we sort of cycle back around and do this. So this is the trajectory of this. Well, if you reflect it and reverse it and do a few other things, there happens to be a letter that looks more or less just like this,
a row.
So the letter row, which is written in this way. So now, the problem that we want to solve is the following. So does everyone understand this purely computational phenomenon? Suppose I give you a function like this, which has finitely many outputs. And then I ask you to iterate the function. It must begin cycling. It simply must. The question is when, how can you detect that you have made it to the cycle? Mm-hmm. So how to detect that you're on the cycle? That is to say that this bit right here, to give them names, we'll call this the tail. And we'll call this the cycle. So that is to say that if at evaluation 475 it really does turn out that 781 is the first time we've repeated an evaluation, that means that what is the tail for this particular situation? Well, it would be 0, 1, 6, 30, 1, 31, 1, 5, 6. These are the things that don't get repeated. Mm-hmm. And then this is now the cycle. So what that means is that if you consider the function iteration, that means that for a certain number of steps that are unknown to you,
you'll be on the tail, you'll be on the tail, you'll be on the tail, on the tail, on the tail, on the tail, and then you'll take a first step onto the cycle. And then once you step on the cycle, all further steps will be on the cycle. You can't get out, you can't break free of it. You just keep going on the cycle. So my question to you is how can you detect that you're on the cycle?
Detect or guarantee that you're on.
Either one.
Something that just fast forward this onto the cycle be sufficient, or?
Here's the thing, is that what does that mean to fast forward onto the cycle? Because I could make the tail arbitrarily
right.
long.
If we start at n factorial step, then we will be on the cycle.
Ah, but I like that, but that presumes that you know what the function is. And I'm
well,
not.
I
won't let you know.
Unknown modulus.
Unknown.
Okay.
But you don't know how it's computed. You don't know anything about it. All that it's a black box. And then I say, okay, I want you to put zero for sake of argument, but it could be anything. I want you to put zero in the black box. And I want you to take whatever you get, and I want you to put it back in the black box. And then it'll produce something for you, and you take that and put it back into the black box. And you just keep watching it. And you want to detect when do you get on the cycle. Yes?
So you could build a lookup table.
Okay. So if you had a lookup table, you could record them all, say. You could start writing them down. And then every time you get a new value, you could check and say, oh, did I get that one before? So in that way, supposing that this really is true, how many values would we have had to store? 475 or 6, depending on how you're reckoning. Okay, so does everyone agree that in principle you could write down all the values, and then every time you get a value coming out of the black box, you could check and say, do I have that one? Okay, so that would work, but it would only work for smallish problems. So here's something that may be of interest to you, is that we've used the random number generator a number of times on MATLAB. So for example, on the NIM problem, to solve the NIM problem correctly, you had to use the random number generator in at least one place. Okay. Now, the random number generator is actually, obviously, not truly random. Okay, so it's called a pseudo random number generator. And the pseudo random number generator actually is not so different than this. The random number generator will actually, let's say that it produces for you a random 64-bit integer. Suppose that it does this. Or to make it smaller, let's say a random 32-bit integer. Well, how many 32-bit integers are there?
2 to 32.
So if the state of the random number generator is of size 32 bits, then what it is essentially doing is it's randomly walking through those 4 billion values. Which is to say, if you have a random number generator of size 32 bits, then after 4 billion steps, it's going to start repeating. Random number generators are basically just this, except the state is much bigger. So you could have a random number generator with a large state, and it's still going to cycle through all these values, but in a way that's statistically good enough to be random. So now, for the lookup table, do we all agree that the lookup table would work in principle? What if I give you a function that has a tail, and a cycle for that matter, that's so long that you couldn't possibly write them all down? Yes?
Could you just use Fermat's little theorem, and then when you get that number, just say, yeah, now we're definitely on the cycle?
Doesn't 2370 need to be prime?
So what y'all are
semi-prime.
What y'all are remembering, I can't remember exactly, but I'm fairly sure. So what you're talking about is Fermat's theorem,
yeah.
Fermat's theorem. Lagrange's theorem, which is more or less the same thing. Which is to say that you might expect the cycle, the length of the cycle, to be a divisor of the modulus, 2370.
But here's the deal, is that I'm going to give you a sequence of numbers, and I don't guarantee to you that they're going to be computed by modulus. So there's in principle no way for you to know how it's being computed. For example, I could say, well, I took all 7 billion human beings, and I had them all join hands, hand to hand to hand. But you're only allowed to look at just one of them at a time. Then I could tell you that actually I arranged them in row fashion. And you're only allowed to look at them one at a time, like they're proceeding through a curtain.
And so I know that when I've looked at the 7 billionth human, I must be on the cycle.
Okay, but now let's mathematically complete it and say there's an indeterminate number of human beings in the problem. So now how do you detect that you're on the cycle? It's an interesting question. And there's a relatively simple answer to it.
So what parameters are we allowed to choose here? Right, like what end step we're at? Or
you can count which step you're at. You say, well, this is the first one, and the next one, and the next one. Mm-hmm. But a lookup table will only work for small problems.
What if we only did n factorials? You know, just proceed amongst the down the factorials. We look at the first index, then the second factorial index, and the third factorial index.
Okay. So then I'll say that then I'll put constraints on the problem, because I think what you're saying is, well, I'll just start choosing really big numbers.
Yeah.
Then surely, if I just choose some really big number according to my reckoning of a big number, surely I must be on the cycle by then. Okay. Yeah, so then I could counter by saying, well, I can think of pretty big numbers. And alternatively, I could say, well, let's say that you have to do it with a somehow minimum number of guesses.
Right.
So for example, if I might say that I might know and I will know how the problem is made, and I know that you can figure it out within 200 guesses, say. So if you respond to me that, well, I figured it out after 200 trillion guesses, then I'll say, that was too many. I need you to do it in less guesses.
We're looking just for a single collision between theoretical entries and...
Mm-hmm. I like the word collision. Now
so
we're getting
just
close.
We're looking for a number that can be generated by two different independent x's. Right?
Yes. Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. What do you think? You got something?
I was going to say, I was thinking if we could detect where the tail ends, and you could just like take the one entry where the cycle starts and just keep comparing it to whatever entries that follow.
Okay, I agree. If you knew when you left the tail, by definition, you would know when you entered the cycle. What do you think?
Well, I was going to say that maybe like every two iterations we could detect, like, you know, because every two iterations would have two in iterations in total, we could compare that to what we had after in iterations.
Ah, I like this. This is getting good. This is getting quite close to the answer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is it going to like follow this monotone increase or decrease or otherwise?
It will not be. It won't be monotone.
Okay.
So you can just construe this as the inputs and the outputs are
random.
Just random. There's definitely a relation between them because it's going to be computed, right? And they're going to be numbers because we're going to solve this problem, but. You know, they could be like fruits or something. I could say, well, you apply the function to an apple and you get a banana. You apply it to banana and you get a pineapple. And then we can iterate through trillions and trillions of fruits. And I want you to detect when you get off the tail and onto the cycle. Okay, so can you, you're quite close to the answer. So you're really quite close to it. Can you say what you said again?
That every two iterations after we have two n iterations in total, we compare that value to the one after n iterations.
Okay. So the answer, so I'll elaborate on what you said. I think you're right on top of it. So does everyone know the story of the tortoise and the hare?
Yeah.
Okay. So then, you know, the original story of the tortoise and the hare is that the tortoise goes slow but doesn't ever give up, and the hare is quite quick, but the hare is not paying attention to what he's doing, and the tortoise ends up winning because slow and steady wins the race. Okay, let's assume that the hare has learned his lesson. Okay. Now, suppose that the tortoise and the hare both begin at the beginning. And let's say that the hare travels two steps, two positions, for every one position that the tortoise does. That is to say that that we've got a clock, or if you like, a loop, and at every tick of the clock, the tortoise takes one step, and the hare takes two steps. So the hare is going faster. Who will reach the loop first? Who will reach the cycle first?
The hare.
Surely, right? Will the tortoise reach the cycle also?
Yes.
Most definitely. But it's going to take the tortoise longer to get there. But because the tail is a finite length, surely they will both get to the cycle. So if they're both on the cycle, and let's say that the hare is closing in onto the tortoise, and let's say that the tortoise is 10 positions ahead of the hare, that means that the tortoise will move forward one step, and the hare will move forward how many steps?
Two.
Two steps. Now how far apart are they?
Nine.
Now they're 9 steps apart. Let's have another clock iteration. The tortoise takes one step. The hare takes two. Now what is their distance?
Eight.
Unbeknownst to either one, right? Because they're both inside of curtains or whatever however you want to imagine it. So in eight more steps, the tortoise and the hare will be at the same spot. The only way that the tortoise and the hare could ever be in the same place is if they're on the cycle. There's no way that they could have collided otherwise. So the solution to the problem that doesn't use an unbounded amount of memory, a lookup table would work if you had an unbounded amount of memory. But the answer to the question that uses essentially no memory whatsoever is that you have two runners, the tortoise and the hare. You start them out, and the first time they collide, you must be on the cycle, because there's no other way they could have collided in the first place. And that's how I'll compute what is the minimum number of steps that you could have deduced that you're on the cycle. So I agree that, okay, in practice, all of these row functions are going to have size probably less than a billion, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to compute them in a reasonable amount of time. So you could say, well, surely after a billion they're on the cycle. Well, I'll be able to say it should have only taken you 436 guesses to establish that they were on the cycle. So any question about the row problem? Yes?
Is there ways to make it more efficient, like if you have multiple points, instead of just two kind of competitors, if you have three or more?
Yeah, you might kind of wonder, like, okay, can I do better? Like, maybe the hare should be traveling three steps and the tortoise one, or, you know, there's all variety of considerations. And in the end, it's sort of problem dependent, because if it's extremely expensive to evaluate the black box function, like if it costs a dollar and you have to do it billions of times, then you basically want to have as few as possible, right? So, but you could say, well, I'll have one that's running at speed 1, one at speed 2, one at speed 3, one at speed 4, and you might hope that you get a collision as soon as possible. In the end, it all just depends on the relative sizes of the tails and the cycles. But that's not what we're worried about. We're just worried about establishing that we're definitely on the cycle. And yes, this is related to
if you wish to look up this discussion, it's related to the Pollard row. Any questions about the two problems? What two problems did we see? Monty Hall and Pollard row. Okay, so these are going to be the last of the new problems for the rest of the semester. So we've got plenty of outstanding work to do, so we're going to solve those. The rest is going to be written homeworks. I'll give you written homeworks where you have to solve exercises that from classes that are prerequisites to this one. Say, like, one of the ones I'll definitely do is, here's a system of linear equations and two variables. I want you to plot the two lines and then show where the solution is. Or plot the two lines and show that there is no solution or whatever. Yes?
How do we do that for the written homeworks? Because, like, we were only given, like, a line of space to write an answer.
That's true, but what I want, it'll be clear, I promise. On number four, the one that we just turned in, yeah, I just wanted you to write the two numbers, whatever they were. But I want you to upload a MATLAB script that computes those. Because right, I'm not interested in you doing it by hand, which you surely can do. Okay, so see you Thursday.